So, the first person I have, the people I have, I'll read three. Ken Anderson from Ithaca, New York. Jeff Stahl, Los Angeles. Frederick Overby, L., Newport News. These people can make their way to the mic. Oh, he did ask?
Maybe we made up.
Any of these people here or not here? Is Anderson here?
I'm Ken Sanderson.
Sanderson.
Now, I did get an opportunity last night to ask the question,
oh,
the last
did.
One, so whoever was behind
okay,
me
fine.
Would be the next person.
Jeff Stahl.
Welcome to the spot here. I see that in the new issue of Fidelio, you've reprinted the experiment by Eratosthenes one more time, and it sort of reminds me of my dad, who, when I didn't get it, he kept telling me over and over and over again. So, I've given this a lot of thought, and if I'm going to be like Eratosthenes, I'm going to probably make a discovery, and then line up the details, do a lot of measuring, and then I'm going to create a situation where I can set it up so somebody can see it, mm-hmm. and then I'm going to create that, what you call, a vicious paradox yeah. that challenges people's belief structure.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to point at that paradox. I'm going to say, look at that. What does that mean? So we get to ask questions. And I have a question and a request. And what I want to do is set up the details and do a little measuring and then ask you a question that you can't answer. Okay. So this week, I live in California, so we have this... governor, his name is Pete Wilson. Mm. And he announced with the stroke of a pen that he removed 70,000 pregnant illegal aliens from getting prenatal health care. Now, what he did was that he robbed those women and their unborn babies of health care and left them on the side of the road to fend for themselves. So what Pete Wilson did was he put a price on a human life. And he told us he was going to save us $69.3 million by doing this for us. So how much does it cost to be the Good Samaritan today in California? Well, you do your math. There's 30 million of us. He's going to save us $69.3 million. So if you divide 69.3 million by 30, it comes out to $2.31. So how much does it cost to be a Good Samaritan if you look at the story in the Bible where the guy sees one on the side of the road? Well, now you have to divide the $2.31 by 70,000, because that's how many he left on the side of the road. And if you do your math, it comes out to 0.00033 cents. That's how much it costs to be a Good Samaritan in California. So I would ask you, because Pete Wilson put a price of 0.00033 cents on a human life. Price do you put on a human life?
I don't put a price on a human life.
I told you couldn't answer that question. Now, that's the paradox. That's my job. And I have to ask people in California that have kids, what kind of price they can put on their kid.
You can't.
And if they can't, I have to ask them, then how come they can vote for a man that can?
Well, because the difference is very simple. That's the issue. That's the issue. Now, how do you deal with a situation like this? You can't deal with it on its own level. You always have to look outside and say, what's the real issue here? We have a constitution. The constitution has a preamble. A preamble is the fundamental law of the United States. Right? Therefore, the governor has committed an impeachable offense by violating the federal constitution, which gives a right to every citizen of the United States, not just a group of people in one state. Therefore, you cannot deprive an American citizen of life or other rights implicit in that by a stroke of the pen, by law. The answer is that everything the Nazis did, for which we hung them under the 1930s trials in Nuremberg, was done according to law. Ridge's defenders tried to defend his Nazi-like crimes by saying the law protects him. Nuremberg says the law doesn't protect him. Nuremberg says the law doesn't protect Pete Wilson. Pete Wilson is accountable as a criminal. Now, how do you deal with this? Do you try to deal with this one-on-one with 70,000 people? You can't do it that way. Not as, you have to do it the other way. You have to say, well, let's hurry up and get rich. Let's defeat the Republicans. Let's say truth in advertising demands we call it contract on Americans. What we have to do is to make the thing that I raised in the Ridge question. You've got to use the term Nazi. And when someone is afraid to use the word Nazi, you can't, that's name calling. See, I'm not controlled by the president. I can name call. As I said, when I want a bottle of milk, I ask for a bottle of milk. That's name calling. When I don't want a bottle of sour milk, I said, don't bring the sour milk. That's name calling. And what we have to do is, the problem we have is not Pete Wilson. Because you've always had killers and robbers and bank robbers and so forth in the country. He's just another burglar, another criminal. He and Ridge are criminals. The entire contract on America is criminal. What's the problem? The problem is, why don't we arrest them? The problem lies not in our purse. The problem lies not in how do we argue against this. The problem we have to address is, why won't they call him a Nazi? Which means that there is a grievous moral failure in the American people, especially in the baby boomer generation. Don't even count Generation X. They haven't started to think yet. It's forbidden. They were told they weren't supposed to think. They're only supposed to make politically correct utterances, not think. So therefore, what you have to do is you have to insult the American people. You have to name call. You stupid, immoral jerk. You typical American. Because you are Nazi. You're like a Nazi. Oh, Germans do that. What do you mean Germans do that? Americans do that. Typical American behavior. 90% of Americans will go along with that. Until you confront them. It doesn't do any good to confront the governor unless you confront the American citizen. And that's where the answer lies. In geometry, this would be changing the geometry of the political environment. If you change the geometry where people recognize, I'll give an example of change of geometry. I was in New York City on December 7th, 1941, a Sunday morning. I had an appointment early in the morning or late in the morning to meet some people at a hotel. Now, in those days, when you stayed in quarters, you didn't have telephones or you didn't have radios around all the time. You saved money that way. Right? So I got up and got dressed and went on to my appointment. And there, I walked into a hotel lobby where I was to meet someone. And I saw people frozen like statues. A lobby full of people listening to a radio broadcast. And that was the announcement of Pearl Harbor bombing. I saw in a very short period of time, in these kinds of samples, that the U.S. population underwent, in a matter of a few minutes across the nation, a transformation in attitude. We are now at a point of crisis where nothing works. Whether the average Joe on the street knows it or not, he is ready to explode. He's ready to explode to recognize that everything that he would have told you is true and absolutely unassailable truth for the past several years, now he's ready to give it up. But he has to cross the threshold to give it up. When he crosses the threshold, as we're finding out in Pennsylvania, what we're doing there, he's going to say, yeah, you're right. The guy is a Nazi. And once you get a movement that recognizes that among the people, you don't have to worry about what's going to happen to this problem. It's going to go. Remember what happened on precisely this kind of question in Pennsylvania. Ridge and his government has already backed down, in part, from some of the provisions. We're not going to quit there. But the wing we have to work on is the immorality in the American people. The simple change in an axiom. It is right to call people by names. If they got four legs, say, look, you're a four-legged something or other. Call them by names. And once you do that, then fine. What happens with people when they're organizing, they say, let's not call the citizen by name. Let's not get them upset. Let's try to sell them a used car instead. Let's try to motivate them to say, well, what are we going to do about these 70,000 women? And that's where you fail. You have to go on the attack. Do the kinds of nasty things I do. And that's how you win. The way we didn't take out Ollie North by trying to get Ollie North to change his views. We didn't get rid of Tom Ridge off his vice presidential ambition by being nice to him or avoiding using unpleasant language, the truthful language. Nor did we defeat Fowler and Morris. We are not finished with them. They've got to come back after us. Don't kid yourself. These guys represent power behind them. And they're going to blame me for what happened. And they're going to come after us, but big. And part of the attack on the Nation of Islam in the Washington Post this morning was a reflection, a reaction to what we did to Fowler and to Morris this past week. Happened this week, it's a matter of what we did. And they were acting that way. So our problem is political. Is to do what I do and don't try to use the methods of the used car salesman to persuade people this is an injustice, this is wrong, what are we going to do to fix it? And say, what's wrong with you, you slob, that you put up with this kind of stuff? That makes you an accomplice in a mass murder.
Well, I said I had a request also.
You had it. Yeah. You don't get half an hour.
Well, my request was just, could we please do to Pete Wilson what we've done to these other guys?
Yeah, we're going to do it. We're going to do it. But the way we do it is by taking one on at a time. Take one on, then we'll make a movement. We'll get them all. Take the lead duck out first. We haven't taken out the lead duck yet.
Thank you.
Okay.
I won't try to give you a slideshow, but you should know the second leaflet we put out against Ollie North was entitled, "If you'd vote for Ollie North, you're probably too dumb to vote."
That's what worked.
And some people got less dumb as a result of that action. I'm sure there are people from Virginia Beach who could give you the wilder reactions they got to that particular leaflet. Is Frederick Overby L. here? Oh, he set up Jerry Belsky. Okay.
Well, Frederick had to leave, but he wanted me to ask you a question, which I think you in part answered already, which is, given that the war on drugs has been conducted as a war essentially against the poor, how can we effectively get rid of the crack cocaine epidemic in the cities? And how get the police to effectively deal with this problem? And finally, how get ministers to stop being afraid of the drug pushers and to come out, since they're only supposed to fear God, not fear these drug pushers, how get them to deal effectively with this problem?
There is fear and trembling around Washington and elsewhere today because of the seemingly mysterious way that we destroyed the political future of Governor Rich of Pennsylvania and that of Fowler and have put Mr. Morris into a new phase where the question is, which of you two was the prostitute? And people, we are blamed for that. People haven't yet caught on to how we did what we did. That is, we set them up to set themselves up. As I said, the principle of justice. Don't go out and take revenge. Take the perpetrator and induce the perpetrator to submit to a test, which you give them the opportunity to atone and purify themselves of their crime, or at least to relent from it. But if they don't relent, their refusal is so structured that they will destroy themselves by their refusal to relent. They haven't understood that yet. But I'm telling you right now, you may not realize it, but you represent in the minds of many people who didn't think so much so some several weeks ago, before the Republican Convention announcement that Ridge was not going to get the nomination. From that time, over the course of the month of August, that you are feared as a potency. So we're playing in a new dimension. And that's the way we attack this problem. We have power. It's not the power of the fist. It's not the power of money. You know that, don't you? But it's the power of ideas. It's the power of principle. The power of creative reasoning. We have the power. We know how to do it. Look, I'll go back to you. Go back to 1973. Why did the FBI inform the Communist Party, according to the FBI statement, saying that if I were eliminated, that their political problems would be solved? Why did they say that? And that was an international operation, remember. This started in February of 73. Didn't start after mop-out, it started before. In January, February of 1973 in Germany. And it involved the Stasi, MI5, the FBI, and other entities. All in the same operation. Why did it done? Why? What was so dangerous about eliminating me? Why eliminate me? How are all the problems going to be solved? Because the enemy had recognized from observing what we did even before mop-up, and the classes which I was teaching at various places like Columbia, that I represented a dimensionality of capability which they recognized as dangerous because of this kind of business. What I'm telling you now, what we do now, this is the way to exert political power. Plato's method, the method of hypothesis. As long as we stick to the method of hypothesis, as long as we don't go running around like rats and opportunists and with political consultants telling us what to do next, and stick to our principles and do what we're supposed to do, we now are, in a sense, on a roll, not a manic roll, but we have power in our hands because of the nature of the world situation. And if we continue to use the right methods, we will be able to exert power. But that means you have to have restraint. You cannot be said, well, we should be fighting this battle over here. We should be fighting this battle over here. The essence of warfare, whether in shooting war or in war of ideas, is the principle of the flank. The principle of flank operates like making a scientific discovery, a principle. The military commander in war, following the principle of Carnot, who happened to be a scientific discoverer, or the principle of von Schlieffen, who describes the process in his review of military history in the famous book Kanai, The Theory of the Flank, is the commander must pick one or two points and concentrate the forces on one or two or more points, not a broad front. Don't dissipate your forces by spreading them to take on every enemy on a broad front of a certain type. Focus on one or two points which you have determined are the weak points where you can focus forces to rout the whole force by turning a flank. It would have been wrong to go out and attack every governor who did what Ridge had done, because we wouldn't succeed in any case. Whereas if you succeed in destroying Ridge, you bring them all down. The trick is you've got to focus on the on a flank, and don't say, what's the project, what's, why don't we go after Weldon, Massachusetts? Why don't we go after this creep of Pete Wilson in California and so forth? No, mistake, typical mistake. Don't be a Marine Colonel Jarhead and send your full regiment going uphill against machine guns. Flank them. Concentrate your forces on what you discover to be the vulnerable flank that you can exploit to advantage against the enemy. You outnumber him, or you have some other factor which enables you to be have assured defeat of him on that flank if you concentrate your forces. And use the victory on concentrating on one or two flanks to bring his whole forces into rout. The way that on the plains outside Arbela, Alexander the Great, having read the Anabasis of Xenophon, knew how to destroy the mass forces of the Persian Empire with a few 10,000 Greeks. He had a million people, auxiliaries and so forth, out on the plains of Gaugamela, outside Arbela. The entire might of the Persian Empire and a few Greek Macedonian hoplites and cavalry. And this force of Greeks destroyed the entire armada, a force of the Persian Empire, by routing it, turning it against itself, by striking at certain points. And in this kind of situation, you have to have the restraint that a great military commander has. Do not throw yourself all over the landscape. Don't attack the enemy on every possible front. That is what Robespierre did and almost lost all of France. Do what Blazar Canot did. Pick your one target. We pick our target globally. We don't let each region decide its own policy. That is suicide. We don't let the United States organization decide its own policy. That would be suicide. We have an international capability, and we must focus our capability internationally on the weak flank of our global enemy. Rout him on a weak flank to the point that we do to him what Alexander the Great did to the Persian Empire out the plains outside Arbela, and what Hannibal did to the Roman, who outnumbered him, had more forces, more weapons, more firepower for the times than the Romans did. The Romans made the mistake of over-concentrating their forces, which limited their mobility and limited their ability to bring their firepower against the inferior forces under Hannibal at that time. Hannibal used that weakness and that error, which he recognized in the Roman forces, and used it to take an inferior force to rout and destroy a superior force. And we're doing just the same thing. That's what we did. That's the decision we made to go against Oliver North. Some people said, you shouldn't do North for this reason, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that, you shouldn't do this, you're going to help Rob, who's an abortionist, or all kinds of idiotic arguments like that. Right? We did it. We began to turn the flank of the conservative revolution in America. We stuck to our guns all the way through on this thing. When even our own people, I had more pressure. Don't do it this way. Why can't we do this way? Shouldn't we start this up in every region? No. Because if you start on a broad front, you cannot concentrate your forces. And people who react emotionally to conflict and political issues lose wars. And I aim to win this one.
Okay, the next people in line are Richard Moore of White Salmon, sounds good. Washington. Mark Walker. You can tell the Norfolk people are the firstest with the mostest here. And then Dr. McClushko.
Well, I finally made it. 3,000 miles to come to see you, Mr. LaRouche.
Glad you did.
Of course, I flew, but not with my wings. You know, I took a shortcut. I used one of them weak Boeing aircraft things, you know, to help out a little. But
you're going to put on a new version next year, one with feathers.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
I said next year they're going to make a Boeing with feathers.
Okay.
It's called an environmentalist aircraft.
Well, you've always amused me. I've been reading your literature now for about 6 months, and it's been quite an edification. I'll tell you that. Even though I've been interested, and for 45 years I've been a political activist of one type or another, fighting for lost causes. I'm one of them losers you're talking about all the time. You know?
Well, you just left the status.
But anyway, I'm an oddball in my own party. I'm a Democratic Democrat, which aren't very many of them. If it's not done democratically, I don't really give a damn about it. You know, I think the people should have a shot at it. And my present Democratic Party is of the few and by the few, and I ain't too damn sure it's not for the few. But anyway, but I want to mention this, that you and I had the same burr under our saddle. It's Don Fowler, but I understand he's past history. Thank God for that. But I'm saying, I just want to put a little nail in his coffin. I would like to add a little nail to his coffin and mention the fact that he turned down efforts of 30, 40 years of political and economic thinking by some a poor guy like myself, who, I mean, you know, I'm nothing much. I'm jack of all trades. I'm a semi-retired school teacher, social worker, you name it, a miner and lumberjack, you name it. I've done it. Jack of all trades and master of none. All right, now the question.
That must be the next guy on the list.
You got your
okay?
Clock back there.
very helpful people here. Anyway, to get back to the issue, what happened for the past 10 years, I made a promise to my friends, my wife. A lot of people say, well, why don't you run for president? Yeah, I run for president, got $10 so I have enough to get out of town on, you know? Sure. And then they shut up. They realize money runs everything. People are disgusted about this. And I'm amazed at how you people function and keep your literature going. It just fascinates me. Anyway, the point is I can't even get through the local newspapers. You understand what I mean? Anyway, to get back to the issue of being disorganized, I tried to make an effort. You know, when Jesus would go like that, people, 3,000 people, they would just keep quiet, you know, listen. When I come to talk in a crowd, everybody talks at once, you know what I mean? That's great, you know. Anyway, and when you talk, well, everybody listens, you know. But one of these days. Anyway, the question is, the question I'm trying to get at is, we've made an effort. I went with several Democrats. We got together and drafted 11-point Democratic Redeal for America. Mm-hmm. This little paper right here. All right, now, actually, about three-fourths of this is in line, and we didn't even have your consultants with us. We come to the same conclusions you did. You people have come to after 30 years of operation. But how did we do that? To the reason, the point I'm trying to get at, the people of this country aren't as stupid as they seem to be. They know something's rotten in Denmark, but they can't do anything about it. All right. The only thing I have to contribute, and the reason I came 3,000 miles, is that I know that with your past record, that you're interested in the best mousetrap, the better idea. Well, I think in one or two points I can add to the Schiller Institute, on one or two points. That's all I can say. And on the one or two points can make a lot of difference. And and I would like to have an opportunity. Would you be interested?
We'll
I'll tell you the history of the
11-point
program.
Just pass it on.
Just
pass
it on.
We'll take a look at it.
You can pass it on, and it will definitely get through, okay?
Okay.
Who's the resident passeronner there?
Pardon?
Oh, it's okay.
Oh, okay. But anyway, I want to point out this 11-point program has been made aware. It's just like the preacher, Mr. Muhammad, got up. We should be aware of God's word, you know. And they should be aware there are solutions, because right in that pamphlet is the solutions, and they're based on basically your ideas, American idea, take over the economy, take over, establish a national bank again, and various other things.
Yeah.
These are all in there.
Good. Right.
Thank you.
But as a Democrat, I've seen both parties flaunt their power and how they treated you people, Schiller Institute, in the last Democratic, it just ended a couple days ago, you know, convention. I mean, it's ridiculous. After all your work, you weren't even seated. You weren't even get an opportunity to give your viewpoint.
Don't worry about it. We got rid of the two clunkers we wanted to get rid of.
Right.
That's a good attitude.
Okay.
But it's not enough. It's not enough. You've got great ideas and a great program. You should be able to reach all the people.
We'll move things this year.
Huh?
Okay.
We're going to move things the next 2 months.
Okay, good.
Okay.
We'll get things moving.
Okay. All right.
All right, my question is this. Even though Fowler did not understand, do you think that you could understand this 11-point program and use some parts of it if it meets your needs, or would you be willing to look at it?
We'll use it if we have to chisel it into Fowler's tombstone.
Okay, is Mark Warner, is Mark Walker here? I happen to know Mark Warner is not here. He's not that smart yet.
I didn't get a chance to change the letters in the election. So.
Speak up a little bit.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you fine.
Okay. This concerns Christian rock. They did a good job on country music this afternoon. I wish they did something on Christian rock. That would have been fun. This concerns the North campaign. I have problems with some of the Christians down there. I'm right next to the microphone. I'm almost eating it. Okay.
There's some background.
Okay. I had dealt with a lot of people that said, they might as well have said, I don't care if this guy puts drugs, I'm going to vote for North because he's a man of God. Mm. I mean, dealing with a situation where reality just wasn't there. They're into their little world, and my question is the role of the particular type of Christian rock they have, mild or rough, whatever, whether that had anything to do with it, because it seems that does isolate people to the point where they might seem pious, but they have no grasp on reality. Otherwise, they should have detected North right away. They had, they seem to support all this.
You hit upon something which is important, is there's no such thing as Christian rock. There is sometimes sin and even sodomy practiced by some so-called Christians, but it has nothing to do with Christianity. Now, the principle is very, very simple, is that Christianity, as Paul says, emphasizes, and particularly in 1 Corinthians 13, is based on the principle of agape, that rock is the cult of Dionysius. That's what it belongs to. The emotions are the most debased of erotic emotions. Anyone who is singing a Christian rock, so-called hymn, is actually defiling the cross and Christianity. It's like urinating on the holiest symbols, icons in the church. There is no possibility of being a Christian and believing this garbage called Christian rock has anything to do with Christianity. As a matter of fact, people have fought against that. You have the worst political, the most corrupt tendencies in all churches, including the Roman churches in Rome, the Catholic Church in Rome, which has bought into this so-called Christian rock or pop music. Like this Amazing Grace, this horrible hymn is musically horrible. The words are even worse. I am a wretch. God is not stupid. God does not love worthless things. Well, in Christianity, the only reason that there's anything for you is because you're worth being redeemed. So it's the good in you, not the wretchedness in you. But to say man is a wretch, but and all to practice something which belongs in a bordello, this is the next, to introduce rock into a Christian church is the next thing to the practice of Satanism before the altar. And no wonder that people who are not sensitive to that fact, who say they go in Christian churches or they preach in them, who is not sensitive to the fact that they can't smell the sulfur and the horns and the clop of the hoofs when the rock starts to be sung, they don't know anything about Christianity. They may know some words that they spew, but if you don't have love of truth, love of justice, love of mankind, which it corresponds to the creative impulse, if you can think that rock or popular country music belongs in a church, you have not yet become a Christian. Or if you were, you stop being it. So the point you make, I think, is an important one.
Dr. McCloskey?
Great privilege that Lynn and Helga visited us in Slovakia in hard election time, second time, 1 month ago. It was a very successful visit with many interesting meetings where Lynn has spoken about 16 hours together with big press responses. Lynn said their former politicians, world and Slovakia needs honest and resolute leaders giving back morality into politics. And Helga said to young people there, the most beautiful and important for you is to keep itself your soul pure, your hands clean. But today's politics, democracy, and economy works on principle of fight, competition, profit by all means, where the strongest win and the weakest lose. Just after the revolution in post-socialist countries, there were no contradictions between politics and clean hands. We had this time slogan, Christians go into politics. Now Christians are kicked out of politics and there is quite other situation. And question, is it possible to be in today's politics where money decide or think with mortality and clean hands? You kick out Morris, Rich, North, Fowler, and so on. How we create such a situation that people like them don't come again back because there are everywhere hundreds of similar politicians like them? It's my question. Thanks.
Well, one of Christ's most powerful sermons was throwing the money changers out of the temple. That the essence of, I think, of politics is leadership. It's intellectual and moral leadership. It is like the command of military forces. That the first thing is you get people out of the barracks. You have people sitting at home with sordid entertainments. You have women on the phone, and not only women, but also their daughters and sons, spending hours of precious money on the phone, gossiping, which is a degraded, immoral practice. Huh? And when people are in the barracks, they may shoot dice or play cards or engage in other things, or they go out looking for trouble, or they go out delivering trouble. And what you do with an army is you know the army can easily degenerate into that, and you move them. The job of the politician is to not to tell people, I want to get your money and your vote, and I'll come back and see you next year. The job of the politician is to be an active leader of people. In the sense of when something has to be said, you say it, get the word out to the people. You decide what has to be moved upon, and you move. There's always something to move on. As Dr. McCloskey knows very well, he's one of those people who likes to move things all the time. He's one of the best organizers I've seen. I've met a lot of good ones in life. But it's very simple. You become a good organizer by doing it all the time. You organize this, then you organize this, then you organize this, then you organize this. You're always organizing something. And that's a real political leader. You may do it in different ways. You may do it from an office, in a political office, by getting on the phone, calling up the key people, saying, look, we got a problem. I think we ought to move on this. And you involve the people in participation in the political process. You don't come back and say, well, I did this for you. I did this for you. I did this for you. You shouldn't have to do that. You may have to explain what you did. But the fact that you did something should be generally known to them. Why? Because you would have involved them in doing it. You say, we've got to get to work on this issue. We've got to get to work on this issue. We've got a nest of poverty out here. By looking at it, it's making me sick. What do you think about it? I think it's what we ought to move on this time. Huh? Or we've got a school that's no good. We've got to do something about teaching and so forth in this school. So a politician at any level is always a leader in the sense of an organizer. It's by some means is getting people moving, getting them out of the houses, getting out of the gossip sessions, out of the backyard, parking lot discussions, and so forth, and getting them to work on organizing society. They say, well, I'm tired. They say, look, you'll have plenty of time to rest after you're dead. Come on, keep moving. There's work to be done. There are missions to be performed. You'll feel better at the end of the day. You'll be tired, yeah, very tired, but you'll sleep better that way. So I think that's the answer, is that what happens is you get, as in Eastern Europe, for example. What I saw in Russia, of course, works, the same people do it differently in countries which are normally part of Western Christianity traditionally, as in Hungary or in Slovakia and so forth. Or in Croatia. Huh? What happens in Russia, they work on a different profile, but they do the same thing. They just adapt it to the Russian culture and ideology rather than doing the same thing they would do in Slovakia. Right? For example, in Slovakia, the International Republican Institute would go in and try to find out the Christian opposition to communism and come out and say, now we're going to give you Western ideology, what they did to the Polish, how they destroyed Poland. They destroyed the church-associated Solidarność opposition in Poland by recruiting it to the Mont Pelerin Society. They tried to do the same thing in Slovakia, the same thing in Hungary. But the same people or the same organizations in Moscow used a different attack. They didn't try to come in with Christian priests saying, this is what you must do, but they used something else. They used businessmen. How to make money in business. You got to get an American contact or a British contact. You got to cut a deal. Look, we'll get George Bush in. Soros will give you some money. Yeah? If you throw your wife and children in cheap on the deal. Right? And that's how they do it. So the problem is if you do not inoculate the people against these kinds of and other kinds of swindles, if you don't keep the people in motion, where they're participating themselves in the process of shaping political life, by participating, knowing what's going on from an inside, there's a difference between looking and saying, I want to read the paper and see what these guys are doing. Then if you're there involved in the process where you're up against it in the street, where you're arguing with neighbors, where you're out there traipsing around door to door in neighborhoods, then you know what the issues are. You know what the problems are. You know who's doing what to whom. You fought it out. You understand it. And that's the difference. Is a real politician can be very effective moral force if they're willing to act on it. But most politicians today won't act. They will say, where's the polls? Where are the polls? Before I open my mouth, I want to know what people approve of. The real politician goes out and doesn't wait to have somebody tell him what the people think is right. The real political leader says what he knows is right, even if 95% of the people are against him. And the guy who says, well, I've got to get a majority of the vote here. I've got to find out what 50%, I've got to triangulate 55% of the vote of the, in terms of public opinion to get elected. And therefore, they've sold their soul to the devil before they entered the race. Anybody, any politician who has a pollster for the purpose of determining what he's going to write in his speech, what position he's going to take on a question based on a pollster, has already sold his soul to the devil. An honest political person goes out and fights to find the truth and states the truth as they know it to the people they're trying to organize. And even if they're wrong, if they have that kind of relationship to the people, then in the dialogue, any problems can get straightened out on rationale. It's the only way to approach it. But you're a genius at it anyway, already. You don't need them.
All right, we have Thelma Barros from Boston, and then a couple people from Nigeria. I don't know if they're still here. Uzoma, oh boy, this is a real challenge. Between Charles Notley's handwriting and the name, it's rough. Uzoma Nwakuche and Promisa King of Nigeria. Promise King. Are any of these people here? Starting with Thelma Barros.
Good. Good evening. I'm from Boston, Massachusetts, and my issue is the economics around the housing issues. I like to see that become an agenda on the political campaign before the election. In 2 months, there's going to be millions of families out in the street pertaining that the Section 8 will be running out. It will be gone. And I'd like to know where is it going to stand on the electrical election this year, and how are we going to prevent it? Now, I know that your institution has played an instrumental role in Boston, Massachusetts, because we are in a crisis right now in Boston, Massachusetts. I, for one, as a resident that's living in the housing development that is at a crisis, and what side of the fence are we going to be on when there's millions of people and millions of dollars have been allocated to Massachusetts for affordable housing, and those same millions of dollars are destroying the housing right now. And I like to say, like you said, name people. Henry Cincinnero, where is he standing, considering that he was the man that had allocated the money to come into the neighborhoods for affordable housing? There was $19 million allocated for cosmetic repairs, and then again, $86 million went into developers' pockets for pure profit. Now, this has to get out into the neighborhoods and into the community and into the government, particularly in the White House and in the urban housing development.
Okay. Well, first of all, the next new Fed issue this week is going to have a feature on the housing question, on this matter.
Okay.
Number two, the way we should do this is treat this as an election issue. Now, the key, we've got a good case in Boston because we've got it well documented,
right,
particularly in this one project. We also know the case of the vault operation in Boston, which is well, which makes it doubly fun, right? Now, what we have to do, we have the same problem around the country. So we've got to get, and people here can participate in making sure that happens. Let me just very briefly describe what we're referring to. And you can see Dennis Speed and so forth afterward if you want more amplification, those who need it, on what we need. Look, when the United States was transformed from an industrial economy to a post-industrial economy, in the middle of the 1966-68 period, everything began to be turned around. As you know from many of you who are close to my generation and some younger, know that there was a change in the U.S. economy where suddenly everything began to go bad. We began to become a post-industrial society, and There was no flow of investment or a constricted flow of investment into anything that resembled real production, particularly from 1973-74, investment in productive industry, energy-intensive forms, capital-intensive forms dried out. Businesses, industries began to collapse, employment began to collapse, the whole business. And then after the effect of deregulation of transportation in 1978, and then the Foeckel measures 79 through 1982-83 especially, the entire economy went dead. Now, what happened is then you find an immediate collapse of the tax revenue base of state and local government. So now you have a city like Boston, and you say, okay, where are you going to get the money to meet the tax rolls for the city of Boston and for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts? Because the industries like the Quincy shipyards, the Navy Yard down there Charlestown Navy Yard and so forth, all these industries, GE used to have 30,000 employees in the area, they went down to who knows what, whole industries disappeared. Where's the tax revenue base? 128 began to shrink. Where's the tax revenue base? Well, what the city of Boston said, what the bankers said, the big insurance cartels that controlled Massachusetts, said to an organization called the Vault, which is operating on State Street, which involved the investment in government and other swindles by this crowd. They said, okay, the municipality of Boston, Greater Boston, has so many square miles of territory. Now, therefore, for Boston to get a tax revenue base, maintain it, we must get so many dollars in tax revenue per square foot of area. Now, we have no industries to get it from. We don't have any productive employment. So what do? We have to pull a real estate swindle.
All right.
We have to get real estate people to invest, increase the tax rate by giving them tax exemptions to get the net, the gross tax base increased. Now that means we've got to swindle the people.
Mm-hmm.
So what you do, where people have a $30,000 investment or a $40,000 investment represented in a home they may own or the equivalent apartment, kick them out. Gentrify the apartment. That started back in the 1960s with the older people in Boston. There were older people, semi-retired, who had fairly large family-style homes. They were kicked out and they began moving college kids in, you know, 20 to the room, right? At high rents. So they began to kick out the traditional residents of neighborhoods and do this. Then they went to real estate speculation. And Nancy Spanos knows a good deal about that sort of stuff because she and her later husband did a lot of work in New York on this study, right? So what they did then is they would say, okay, we'll let the real estate sharks steal so much and we'll take a small percentage of it. So the entire federal, state, local housing policy of government in the country was steered in this direction. This became a policy known as Negro removal.
Right.
Kick people out of the community, throw them into a worse slum, throw them out of the slums, and throw them into the countryside. That's how we got the big homeless problem in many of our cities. So this is a national problem in which we have a case in Boston where the people involved, Thelma's involved with this, are very clear on the problem. The question is, how do we deliver the result we have to deliver to try to change this? All right, we've got a former head of HUD is running as the Republican vice presidential candidate. Very significant point.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mr. Haircut, when you were running HUD, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, look, we have this swindle that was being run with the cooperation of your agency.
Mm-hmm.
And they tried to charge with some of the people working your agency with corruption, but that wasn't the problem. The agency was a corruption.
Right.
And with agencies, working with agencies like the Vault in Boston, to effect Negro removal, to create a homeless disaster on our streets with people whose incomes were sufficient to pay rent formerly, but who can no longer afford to pay rent to have decent housing. You've broken up communities, we have crime spreading, and you're to blame. Now, why'd you do that? And what do we have to do to change it? Are you willing, if you become elected, would you change it? And then give some numbers about how many people in the country are suffering as a result of that policy. You call it a fair housing policy, you call it access to housing, whatever you want to call it, and it isn't. It's a swindle, which the government has gone into partnership with people like those who back Filthy Will Weld in Boston, who's a left-winger anyway. What are you doing in the party with a left-winger? And to swindle the American people rather than giving him industry, rather than letting him have agriculture industry. So what we have to do is we have to package that case, take the Boston case, which speaks for itself in a sense, take the relevant laws, but people won't understand that. So let's take around the country a few more examples and say, here is something that happens in Boston. It's a national pattern. Some people call it Negro removal. It's putting people on the streets, it's building up a homeless problem, and it's done because it's a deal between real estate speculators and financial speculators otherwise, and HUD. And we've got to stop it. And that's, I think, we have to approach it. But we have to go like a steamroller, put a package together, and then ambush a bunch of political people. And no, with no limits on it. Ambush everybody. Anybody who's running for Congress. Say, look, this is a scandal. This is dynamite if it's done properly. And I think we can do it.
Amen.
See her.
A couple announcements. If you've left anything with security, please pick it up at the end of this panel outside the meeting room at the metal detectors. Then also, just to repeat, individuals staying in the hotel who are attending tomorrow's business meeting, which will be at 11, should check out before that meeting. And people staying for the cadre school, which is between Tuesday and Thursday, should hook up with their hosts as soon as possible. If you don't know who your host is, speak with Pat Salisbury. The next question is the gentleman from Nigeria.
Mr. LaRouche, sir, it is a great honor for me to address you tonight. Nigeria, as you know, of a country of about 100 million people. I'm not sure of the statistics, but it would appear that at least four to five black people in the world is a Nigerian. And the problem in Nigeria is obvious. My family has been involved since after the war with infrastructure development. We have a concrete manufacturing factory. And everything was going well until the 80s when the IMF started the devaluation of the currency. And we saw our production capacity go down from 80% to almost less than 20%. But something is happening right now which seems to be offering some sort of hope to the country, because the current current military leader of Nigeria is, in a way, saying no to IMF. The country needs the country needs Shiloh Institute. The country needs your ideas desperately at this time. We need to inform, to disseminate information to the country. In 1998, there will be, hopefully, a handover of government with a general election. And we are hoping that that wouldn't draw the country back to the control of British government through the IMF and the World Bank. This is more of a comment and a question. Is there a strategy? And I know that a lot of information is in place in Nigeria and educating people, but within Nigeria, is there a strategy to disseminate more information because of the strategical position which this great country, Nigeria, holds in the world today?
Well, the problem is this, that the problem of Nigeria is twofold. As you indicate, there's an internal problem, development problem, because there's been a great demoralization among the people of Nigeria because of the lack of spread of development. That is, and because Nigeria is a country which is victimized by a long period of British colonial occupation in which people who were educated went to London or came under British influence, some degree U.S. influence, which wasn't much better in some respects, and then went back to their own country as being a more educated in terms of international cultural knowledge, skills, whatnot, and were tended to be soft on British ways or the worst kind of American ways. And there has been not a development under these conditions of global contraction. Remember, we had up at 1967, 71, 72 was the period at which the development process in the developing sector as a whole went negative. There was a post-war growth in certain parts of the developing sector. Then with the about the time that Utant read the second development decade paper at the UN in 1967 was the time the whole thing was dying down with the Wilson government starting to plunge into this present disaster. So you have an internal problem of people who have not experienced recently the magnitude of development that would reach and change the outlook of the Nigerian people sufficiently so they would have a spontaneous sense of what has to be done, which I think is a dangerous internal condition in which you get hustling, as we call it here, as opposed to an orientation for nation building and economy building. The problem, however, is that Nigeria, like Sudan in particular, is a besieged economy. In Sudan, I talked, of course, as you know, with a number of people from Nigeria over a period of time. We've been in touch. I've had friends of mine there since 1982 when Alan Salisbury went there before me. And I did some papers on the subject of Nigeria and its role in development at that time. But in looking at what I know of Nigeria and its leadership and problems today, and looking at Sudan, in some respects, Sudan is better off. The reason that Sudan is in some respects better off, not in terms of per capita income and things like that, but Sudan was never really effectively colonialized. Because the people in 1898, remember, up until 1898, they kicked the British out. They destroyed Chinese Gordon. They established their independence and were a power in their region for a period of time. And they never forgot it. Now, Nigeria never had a successful war against the British Empire because it wasn't a Nigerian nation. The Nigerian nation was created more recently. And they had a successful effort in the time of when Nasser was organizing the United Arab Republic, which was an inspiration to leaders in Nigeria to pull the nation together and have three nations. But they never had that. So that they're, in terms of understanding of national goals, when you look at Sudan, what I know of the people of Sudan, what you know with people of Nigeria, that Nigeria has a deficit in this respect, even though Nigeria has more immediate access to wealth on the world scale under normal conditions. The problem is, however, that both countries, like other countries which are so-called developing countries, share the common problem that there is no global allowance for any development. If the IMF were to discover any successful development in Nigeria, they'd come in to kill it right away. Or they'd send the World Bank in. Or they'd have some strike would be organized on the payroll of Royal Dutch Shell or something like that, or ITT or something like that. So I think what you're saying about development is very important, internal, education, so forth. The problem is that the Nigerian is going to say to me, the typical Nigerian, not the leaders who will say, we need this, he's going to say, but how do I feed my family next month? How do I get the education? How do I get these needs next month? Be practical. Huh? And of course, that's very impractical, but it's understandable. So therefore, the problem is that we have to crack the enemy, power, fight to keep from drowning in the meantime. Once we crack the enemy's power, then we can do what we wish to. And that time it'd be possible to say, well, this is we got our country now, we can do things, so we're going to start doing them. And the initiative will have to come from the central government, which is the only agency which can coordinate sufficient wealth in infrastructure to get the country really moving on any of these projects. Large-scale infrastructure projects are the key to it. However, we don't have to be pessimistic and say, hold off, forget practical ideas, hold off until the better season comes. Because the time for change is now. What you're seeing breaking out in France right now, in France is on the edge of a general strike, which potentially is much more profound and more serious than what happened in 1968 in France. It's organic, it's throughout the country. It's not limited to a certain section, the students and so forth, section of the population. This situation in France is typical of the situation around the world. The reason that we are able to do what we're able to do politically in the United States today, the reason we were able to knock off North, the reason we were able to set up a Fowler to destroy himself and Dick Morris to destroy himself and Ridge to destroy himself, is a reflection of a new condition in the United States itself as well as worldwide. Everybody knows or should recognize the United States right now is dying. It is in mortal toil. Is dying. The U.S. economy is dying. And cannibalism has broken out among the Republicans. Kill off the useless eaters. Kill people who want to be paid. Save what money we've got for those of us who need it to keep our pockets warm. And so we're in a time when the entire global shebang is about to blow up. We're about to go into a long dark age, which either most of the human race dies off, or we escape the dark age and establish an order. We are coming to a point where for a very brief period of history, maybe weeks, maybe months, that the enemy will be defeatable. Let me qualify what I mean by that. Who is the enemy? Now, Nigeria is a part of the Commonwealth, and therefore you know something about the Commonwealth from the experience from looking at it from inside Nigeria. The Commonwealth is more politely described as the British Empire. The British Empire never left. It simply turned over the costs of management to local employees while keeping a mortgage on the place in the form of things like Royal Dutch Shell, British Petroleum, these kinds of things, ITT, whatnot. So the way the British Empire functions is like the Persian host. Inside the Persian host, you had an inner core of fighters. Were called the immortals. These were the sons and daughters of leading Persian families, generally oligarchical families, whose sons and daughters would take up a military profession as the Achaemenid fighters corps. But the Persian Empire had a limited number of the so-called immortals with their basketwork shields. Most of the Persian Empire was composed of a host of auxiliaries, of like Napoleon's horde marching into Russia in 1812. An army of, not French, but mercenaries, auxiliaries. The power of the British at the core, they're very powerful at the core, very tough at the core. Of course, you've got a lot of laws and goof-goofs and so forth around there, but that, you got a few inner core who really know what's going on. They're dangerous. But like the Persian Empire, the British Empire is a Babylonian host ruled by the Whore of Babylon, reincarnated in the form of the mad cow who sits on the throne over there. So therefore, when you get into a period where all of these auxiliaries, admirers in the financial community, and you got to see these goofballs that run the trust funds in New York City these days, they're absolute goofballs. Read the Wall Street Journal. There isn't a brain in the joint. They're all babbling idiots. But the British depend upon their auxiliaries. Their auxiliaries in every country, the prostitutes who are owned by the British, who suck up to the British, who would think the greatest thing in the world to stand within 6 meters of the Queen. All you have to do is go to New York City. You can stand in the midst of all the queens you want to. Now, these are the auxiliaries. These are the Persian host. Come a financial crack. All of these idiots start jumping out of windows and doing other wild things. They are routed, self-routed, by the breakdown in their dream, their delusion. So at that point, the inner core, while it's still tough and dangerous, its auxiliaries aren't functioning so well. That is the time you defeat them. Now, what we are approaching is exactly in the coming months, maybe earlier, we're approaching exactly that condition. If we do not take on the monster at that time, that interval of opportunity, he will come back in some other form. But if we move then, we can destroy him while his auxiliaries are dismayed and routed before he can get them back in order. So we're moving to the moment of opportunity. Therefore, the consciousness of forces around the world has to be, forget all the argument, don't pay attention to what some says, oh, the system will go on forever. Pay no attention. That's a weakness of the enemy, that his auxiliaries think this system can somehow go on forever. But concentrate on recognizing that when the crack comes in any area, it's a moment to seize power. Not to talk about seizing power, but to seize it. And therefore, leaders of countries who are patriotic, who understand this problem, will say, we'll seize power because we know that we understand what we have to do. That is, we have to use the seizure of power, taking it away from these guys, in order to have the right, the power, to decide for ourselves what we're going to do with our country. Because until we do that, we're not going to have the power to decide what we do in our own country. So therefore, we, who are the leaders, must make sure that we know what we tell the people at the time we seize power. Because the people aren't going to listen to us until they believe that we're coming into power. They think we're going to have power. They're going to say, what are you going to do? You say, well, we should do this. They say, it's never happened. Never happened. And that's our problem. So, yes, I accept fully the proposition you make about the need. And we're doing what we can on that. You can find out from Larry and others what we are doing specifically in that direction. But I wanted to add the qualification that we have to look at this in perspective. And the perspective is we have to win a war. Then we will have sovereignty. Then we can do what we have to do. In the meantime, the people are then going to turn to people they regard as leaders and say, okay, now you've got the power. What are you going to do with it? What are you going to give us? And then you have to say to them, well, we're not going to give you anything. We're going to give you the opportunity to do something for yourself. Right? Yes, Ronnie. I think we're going to have to. Anyway.
Okay. Go ahead, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am here to thank this institute on behalf of well-meaning Nigerians. I want to personally thank Mr. LaRouche for his courage, his character, his confidence, and for his energy. I am in Nigeria who is concerned about my nation. Because of that vision, I have seen that Chila Institute genuinely cared about my nation. When everyone else looked away, Chila Institute was there for Nigeria. We've been raped, dehumanized, debased, and bastardized by the British missionaries. We still be raped at the moment, but too bad they are using condoms now. They are using our brothers now. They are using worthy servants now. And I am excited that there are institutes, there are men like you here who are members of this institute, who stand for what is right for my country. And for that, I owe you one. My question is, I don't want to take much of your time, is how will you assess American U.S. policy towards Nigeria. Because for years, I have been in this country as a reporter for one of the local newspapers. I have seen the hypocrisy and the unrealistic approach to development. I simply don't understand how you will assess U.S. policy towards Nigeria. Thank you.
Okay. On the question of U.S. policy to Nigeria, you have to realize we're a divided country. We have patriots and traitors in our country. And since 1901, as you saw today in the presentation by the Tarpley Traveling Tavern Players with marching band, that there was not only a Confederate treason in this country, and Tony Chaikin has written a good deal about treason in the United States. Matter of fact, he is actually sort of the recording angel on this question. Well, his little career he's picked up. But since 1901, with the assassination of McKinley, power fell into the hands of traitors, who were the same thing as the powerful financier oligarchy of the nation, which is practically an extension of the British monarchy, or the British financier oligarchy, same thing. So therefore, we are a nation which, when I came back from military service at the end of the war, this was a nation which knew that the British were our enemy. The British Empire should be destroyed. The British way of doing business, which we call free trade, or Adam Smith, was immoral. That was the understanding of the majority of Americans when I came back from service, in their optimistic mood. That is the American intellectual tradition, as Kissinger likes to refer to it and say he's trying to destroy it. There is in the American people and their character, in ways of which they're not even aware many times, of a commitment to this, just like our friend from Oregon was speaking about, you know, 11-point program. Any American who comes from my generation, or perhaps slightly younger, who lived through the time of coming out of the Depression during the war, going into a post-war depression and sort of coming out of it, the experience of the space program and so forth, recognizes from experience in life that we had embedded in us certain senses of values which made the United States economy the most powerful economy in the world. That we know how to do that, and many Americans know that. Even baby boomers know it if you can tie them down long enough to keep them away from the television set. So we have that. And that type of American faced with something like Nigeria or any other part of Africa, if they had experience, particularly in production or in engineering, would look at a country, they go into a country, a farmer. We sent farmers into Africa, American farmers, when we still had them, a decade or so ago. And the American farmer, looking at the African situation, would come back and give a report and say, this is what we saw. We talked with people, we looked at the problems, here's what their problems are. Or the person with an engineering or the production background would have the same response. They say, no wonder they can't do anything. They don't have roads. They don't have them fixed up. Their river system, their water system, it stinks. The water's filthy. They have no service for the farms, no little communities that serve the farms with services that needed to make them productive. And the typical American would think that way. Well, the baby boomer has gone into the post-industrial society, and he no longer believes in the human race. He believes in lotus eating, in pleasure. He believes in his entertainment. His job is a place to be entertained. Ah, no. It's his club, his organization. It's his cult. And he goes out there, he wants to be entertained. He talks about his entertainment. And then one day he dies. He says, hey, this isn't entertaining anymore. And they even try to make an entertainment of that. The problem is that you have two Americas. You have the America of the oligarchs who are evil, and they dominate our politics. Then you have the rest of us, particularly of my generation and slightly younger, who recognize what reality is. And just like a friend with his 11-point program raising that question, those of us from that experience have a certain common understanding of what needs to be done to make things work. If you can mobile, that's the American attitude. Then you have the baby boomer generation who doesn't believe that reality is real or that it's undesirable, that virtual reality is better. Consensual pragmatism, as I call it. Some call it cultural determinism. The organizational principle, the idea that whatever we believe is true is right. The American who says, well, all my friends would agree with me. Why, they stupid too? Right? So they're oriented to what they, fashionable opinion. You have politicians who would ask pollsters what they should tell the American people. Obviously, if you have to tell the American people something, they don't know it. So what are you going to ask them? What you're going to ask them for their opinion first? It's stupid. But that's the problem. So with a question is a question of power. The power has to change from the hands of those who represent the financier oligarchy, who will always have a bad attitude. And those in the Congress and others like Carol Moseley Brown, for example, who was almost hooted out of the convention. She's a senator. A U.S. senator from Illinois was almost hooted out of the convention, shunned by the vice president, shunned by that famous prostitute, Jesse Jackson, who's trying to run against her. He's best qualified for running in a gynecological clinic. And she went to Nigeria, looked at the conditions, came to certain conclusions. She's an intelligent woman. And when she said the truth, Gore shunned her. They left her on the street without transportation. They wouldn't even take her to her next destination. She was treated like a pariah because she told the truth. And that's not wanted in those precincts. So the answer is, what my answer in life, don't try to get them to accept an opinion. Go out and force them to accept an opinion by doing what we have to do.
We're going to take two more, and that's it for this evening. Make sure that if you left anything with security, you pick it up, and that you get in touch with people who are going to host you at the Cadre School. So the last two people are Mark Jeffers of Baltimore and Ann Buffing-Sydenham. I probably massacred that, I'm sorry. From Battle Creek. Ann from Battle Creek, Michigan. Are either of those people here?
Name Charles Notley for spelling.
Who? Okay.
I am awed, sir, at your world knowledge. But as of tomorrow, I have to go home to back home. And I have been invited to a Republican dinner for Nick Smith. Now, I like some things about him. Sometimes I split my ticket. I'm not going to ask people to raise their hands on how many came from a Republic background. But one of the things that I like about him is that he receives no PAC money. And I wanted to ask if you think that lobbying is somewhat immoral. I think that PAC money is pure bribery. But that's not my big problem. My big problem is that the new Republican candidate for vice president, Kemp, was going to speak at this dinner, and he obviously won't be there. But guess who will be there? Gingrich. And I was going to ask you, in the spirit of agape, what dynamic questions I can ask him. I learned lots of names that I could call him here.
Bottle of sour milk.
But I didn't know if that was exactly the right thing to do. Then other things you said, perhaps I just better shut up and sit down at the dinner and let you take care and cremate him some other way.
You going to say about Smith?
What?
What about Smith?
This calls the feedback cushion.
Okay. Well, the problem is, I think with Smith, you may have a better case with Smith than Gingrich. I can't even be sure what, I've never been quite sure which end of his body he pulls the trousers up on. I mean, but in the case, I don't know Mr. Smith, but I understand he's for privatization of Social Security. And to me, that's a no-no. All right. So that's a no-no. Why not go back? Why don't we recognize that years ago, we are not able to pay now what we used to afford 30 years ago, 25 years ago? Did it occur to him that perhaps maybe deregulation of transportation, the Folker measures, Kemp Roth, Garn St. Germain, and so forth, and Graham Rudman might have done this to us? Or derivative speculation might have done to it. And maybe instead of trying to adapt by destroying essential structure of American society, wouldn't it be better to look at the time when we still had a successful economy, back, say, 1966, and find out what we'd done in the past 30 years which lessened the percentile of the labor force which had skilled industrial employment, which destroyed the literacy of high school and university graduates, where a university graduate today is less literate than a typical high school graduate 30 years ago. And maybe instead of coming up with all these gimmicks to plow more money into Wall Street and some of these other things, maybe we should balance the budget by increasing the tax revenue base by investing in industry and agriculture and modern technology, the kinds of things we used to do that made us successful, rather than investing in gambling in a speculative derivatives market which is about to blow up. I think that's the key question. However you formulate it. And dealing with a Republican, you can only shame them. I mean, what can you say to them? Didn't you think that this used to be a great country? Don't you think the party of Lincoln ought to stick to the principles of Lincoln? Don't you think we ought to be an agro-industrial power and invest in infrastructure the way Lincoln did? Lincoln made a revolution in defeating these crazy Confederate agrarian goons in building a great nation, despite the fact the British shot him because he was doing too well. Maybe it's better to go that way. Maybe the route from Lincoln through McKinley was a better way when the Republicans were still Republicans before they became Confederates. Maybe it's better to go that way. Maybe we were a better nation under Roosevelt. We were in a depression in the 1930s. I sort of recall that Mr. Coolidge and Mr. Hoover had something to do with that depression. And I recall that Mr. Roosevelt let us out of it. And I recall that despite all the bad things that were said about Roosevelt, that economy continued to prosper relatively until about 1966, when it began to make changes. Funny ways of thinking that we never did before. And the economy went downhill, and the tax revenue base collapsed. Maybe we should go back to what we were doing before instead of trying all these funny gimmicks. Instead of starving and poisoning and gagging people to get their money, maybe we should go back and earn some money again. Not...
Okay, I declare this open conference closed. Those at the business meeting will arrive here before 11 o'clock tomorrow. Thank you all very much.